Hi everyone, it's Anthony. Welcome to another Public Domain Day video from the Newnham Carnegie Library. We've got some amazing pieces of literature and other forms of media that have come out this year for the public domain. This year, 2022.
This year, 1926. 96 years from 1926, and all of these things that I'll be talking about today have joined the public domain. All right, we're gonna start with novels, because we're in the library, like I did last year, and it's gonna be a whole lot of fun. I've got six that I'd like to talk to you about this year, some really amazing pieces of work. The first that I'd like to talk to you about, Agatha Christie's Murder of Roger Ackroyd. Now, The Murder of Roger Ackroyd is probably the first Agatha Christie novel that I ever read, either that or Murder on the Orient Express. Agatha Christie is an amazing mystery novelist. She's from England and she's done some amazing, amazing work. You've heard of Miss Marple, you've heard of Hercule Poirot, hopefully you've heard of these things. I'm not going to force you to be any kind of literature stuff, but this one is particularly about Hercule Poirot. He is retired, and he is going to live in this town near a friend, but his friend gets murdered. And Hercule Poirot has to come out of retirement to discover who murdered his good friend. This is gonna sound kind of crazy, especially since I just brought up Murder on the Orient Express, but Murder of Roger Ackroyd is my favorite Agatha Christie novel. It is widely considered her masterpiece in murder mystery literature. And the twist ending in this book had one of the biggest impacts in the murder mystery genre, in the crime thriller genre of literature. It's absolutely amazing. If you ever get the chance, I highly suggest it. It's in the public domain now, and you can do and use it in any way that you want. Make your own movie, rewrite the book, sell it in your own way. I love it. Check it out. Like I said, one of my favorites, absolute favorite Agatha Christie novel. The next book I would like to talk to you about is Hugo Gernsback's Ralph 124C41. Now, that name might sound quite ridiculous, but Hugo Gernsback was a Luxembourgish-American sci-fi writer who was very mechanically oriented. The numbers, they make a lot of sense in that way, but also they mean 1, so 124C or 1 plus means 1 to 4C for one another, and I think that is sweet and awesome. This isn't a really great read, but it's really exciting that I think that it's in the public domain, because we can see 96 years ago, people had these ideas about technology and all that jazz, and this book made many successful predictions of future technology and ideas, kind of like that H.G. Wells book that I told you about last year that made a lot of successful predictions of the future. This one did as well, which is why I think it's incredibly notable. Some of the things that he kind of guessed about and maybe even saw in our future: television, the concept of channel surfing, the video phone, transcontinental air services, solar energy, like in its kind of productive use that we can see it in today, movies with sound in them rather than silent pictures, synthetic milk and food, artificial cloth, tape recorders, and space flight. Like I said, not a very good read, it's not a good book, but the fact that he had such successful predictions of the future, I think makes it really noteworthy, and maybe check it out if you want to. You don't have to. Next book I'd like to talk to you about is from the English author Sylvia Townsend Warners in her book, Lolly Willows. Lolly Willows is an early feminist classic book about a woman named Laura Williams who moves to the country after living as a live-in aunt with her family after her father died. After she ended up leaving the house and moving to the country, she picked up witchcraft. And her nephew moves into that town to try and be closer to her aunt because he doesn't know how to live his own life. And Laura scares him away using her witchcraft. And it's absolutely amazing. I highly suggest it. I've read the first couple chapters so far, and I'm really enjoying it. It's one of the first books in the United States that was a part of, like, the major book clubs. Now, the next book that I'm going to be talking about, as you all probably knew I would bring it up, is A.A. Milne's Winnie the Pooh. This English author wrote this book, and every single chapter in it is a different story. You know the story of Winnie the Pooh, probably because you read the books as a child, or you grew up, or have just seen Disney's interpretation of Winnie the Pooh.
I haven't thought of anything, have you? No, neither have I.
I need you to understand about Winnie the Pooh. You can use Winnie the Pooh in your own works of fiction and all that jazz. However, if he has a red shirt, he still belongs to Disney. The Winnie the Pooh in the book does not have a red shirt and is a stuffed bear. So take heed about what goes on in the book and what you can pull away from it and compare it to the Disney elements and take away the Disney elements. Those don't belong to you yet, just the stuff from the book. But however, you can continue to utilize right now and make money off of, do whatever you want with, the character of Pooh, Christopher Robin, Rabbit, Piglet, the Woozles, Eeyore, Owl, the Heffalumps. We're not quite to Hufflepuff yet. The Heffalumps, Kanga, and Roo. There are many, many different adaptations of Winnie the Pooh. Make sure that you're using the one from the book. However, if you are going to check out other adaptations of Winnie the Pooh, I highly suggest the Soviet Union version.
А зачем на свете пчелы? Для того, чтобы делать мед. По-моему, так. А зачем на свете мед? Для того, чтобы я его ел. По-моему, так.
Probably, in my opinion, better than the Disney Winnie the Pooh. It's wonderful. The next book we're going to be talking about is the Argentine author Ricardo Girardellis and his book, Don Segundo Sombra. This book is based off of the real life of Segundo Ramirez, and it is a book that presents the lifestyle of a gaucho. If trying to understand what a gaucho is, think of kind of like the American cowboy. And this is a really romanticized type of archetype and character in Argentine literature and in real life. Instead of writing it as like an adventure story, though, Ricardo Girardellis talks about how the gaucho is more of a shadow over Argentinian history. And the book is really meant more as a warning to the youth of Argentina that Girardellis thought of as restless. So it's a really interesting book, and I highly suggest you take a look at it. The sixth book that I'd like to talk to you today about is called Flight by Walter Francis White. Walter Francis White was a Black American author who was also the leader of the NAACP from 1925 to 1955. I just thought that was a really interesting fact, and I wanted to share it with you. Flight is about a New Orleans Creole woman who passes as white, which makes sense because Walter Francis White was a blonde and blue-eyed Black man, and she is able to pass as white, but is found out and has to move away from her wealthy family and has to move to Harlem, where she is also pregnant. It's a very interesting book. It's very difficult to find. I was able to read a couple snippets from it here and there, but what I read was very well done and is considered one of Walter Francis White's biggest pieces of work. It's really, really such a shame that it's very difficult to find, but if you can, please put a link down in the comments. I would really like to read more of it than just a couple snippets that I found. Thank you very much. Past novels, it was very difficult for me to find a lot of interesting nonfiction that came out this year. But there are a couple of plays that I would like to talk to you about. And by plays, I mean dramatic work meant for the stage. There are two plays that I really wanted to talk to you about that I found that came out this year in the public domain. And that is Zora Neale Hurston's Color Struck and Sean O'Casey's The Plow and the Stars. My background in the theater is specifically Irish dramatic literature. So Sean O'Casey, I do know already from his play, The Juno and the Peacock. First, I'd like to talk to you about Nora Neale Hurston's Color Struck, which is about a young Black woman who's afraid that her boyfriend will leave her for a lighter-skinned Black woman. Years later, after her and her boyfriend break up, she is given birth to a mixed-race daughter who she has accidentally allowed to die when her old boyfriend tries to come back into her life. It is a very, very strong and powerful play that discusses the themes of colorism, and I highly suggest you check it out.
This is the woman I've been wearing over my heart like a rose for 20 years. She so despises her own skin that she can't believe anyone else could love it. 20 years. 20 years of adoration, of hunger, of worship.
On the verge of tears, John crosses to the door and exits.
It's yours to play with now, however you want. Show it for free at your local theater. I highly suggest that you do. And Sean O'Casey's The Plow and the Stars takes place around the 1916 Easter Rising and deals with the ideas of the dangers of Irish patriotism and fanaticism. It wasn't loved in its initial few days of a run in Ireland, and even caused a riot from the people who actually fought in the Easter Rising, thinking that the play was aimed as a criticism towards them specifically. It is One of my favorite plays is Crazy Bananas and Kind of Miserable, especially towards the end. I highly suggest that you take a look at it. It's in the public domain. Check it out. Use it. Show it for free at your local theater. Have a lot of fun with it. A couple of the films that came out in the public domain this year that I would really like to discuss with you. I'm not going to show as many as I did last year because things are really difficult to actually find good footage of, but three notable pieces of work that did come out in 1926 that I would like to discuss with you are The Adventures of Prince Ahmed, which is a German film that is based on the 1001 Nights. It is the oldest surviving animated feature film, and it was directed by Lottie Reiniger and Carl Koch.
And it's something that you want to do, make sure that you are in love with it. And if you're too in love with it and you're too passionate about it, don't always monetize something that you're in love with. It might hurt your feelings about that art style in the long run, but it is now yours. All of these are now yours. Have fun with them and check them out. And like I told you last year, you've heard some music in the background while we've been talking. All of that music is now in the public domain as well. Here's a quick list of some of the most notable pieces that I found and I would like you to check out.
I'm rolling along, yes, rolling along, and I'm quitting the blues of the world. I'm singing a song, yes, singing a song. Glory, hallelujah, just hold upon.
Thank you so much for stopping by the Noonan Carnegie Library with me today. I love talking to you about the public domain, and I really think that you're going to have a good time with it. If you have any questions about some of these things that you'd like to see, or if you have any questions about other things that might be in the public domain, I would love to hear those questions, and I can't wait to hear back from you again. Have a wonderful day. Please stay safe. Bye, everybody.
I've only got one suit, just one. That's all I can wear.